Welcome, you are listening to the Twice Over Movies podcast. In these first few episodes, I'm going to spend just a couple of minutes explaining who we are and what we are doing with this podcast and website. So as you can tell, this podcast is specifically about movies. My name is Faraz and I'll be hosting each episode alongside a rotating co-host between Fahad, Yusuf, and Farhan. Each episode is for one movie. We will spend 10 to 20 minutes discussing our scores without giving away any major spoilers. Afterwards, we will have a spoiler alert, and then we will dive into a deeper discussion into the movie. And that will go as long as it goes, maybe 15 to 45 additional minutes. Our scores are broken into five segments of a movie. First, acting, defined as the execution of the writing and story by the actors. Second, direction and plot, defined as the entertainment value, pace, and audience connection. Third is the writing, which is defined as primarily the dialogue. Fourth is the cinematography and photography, defined as the visual appeal of the movie. Fifth, themes and motifs, defined as the presentation of the underlying message and or idea. For each of these categories, we assess if it was substantive, purposeful, logical, engaging, satisfying, clear, consistent, etc. This is where the website comes into play. Depending on how you order the importance of the categories mentioned, you will get a composite score indicating the strength of the movie on your standards. Currently, you will see a score based only on how the host rated the movie, but we have every intention to include you into the process to add a community score alongside the host score. We hope you enjoy the podcast, continue listening, and support us. Now on to the episode.
핸드폰도 다 끊기고 와이파이도 다 끊기고 응? 씨발 계획이 뭐야? 응?
기우야.
예 아버지.
와이파이 높게 들어야 돼 높게. 구석구석 그 사사시 그저 해야 돼. 아이씨 꼭등이.
어! 여기! 잡힌다!
진짜? 잡혔어?
어! 잡히지! 이거! 카피나라 2지! 이 근처에 카페 새로 생긴 건가?
뭐야, 왜 나 안 잡히지?
일로 바싹 올라와봐!
얘들아! 되는 거야?
어! 돼!
아, 자, 그러면은 자, 카톡 한번 확인해봐! 자, 피자 시대 연락 준다 그랬거든!
어! 잠깐만! 어! 여기 있네! 피자 시대!
Welcome everyone to the Twice Over Movies podcast. This is Faraz, your host.
And this is Yusuf, your other host. What are we talking about this week, Faraz?
This week we're doing something new and different for us. We're reviewing a movie we watched at the theaters. So we don't get the benefit of pausing, taking our notes, rewinding, rereading the subtitles, whatever.
I gotta say, for people who review movies, we probably should have gotten to this experience sooner on, because that's kind of how people watch movies. So this was not as easy as I thought it would be. So this should
definitely
be
not as easy as I thought it would be. Yeah, and I did take a notepad with me to take notes, by the way, and I can't say it was as helpful as I thought it would be.
You just look like a nerd for no reason. That's what happened.
So the movie that we're reviewing today is Parasite. South Korean film from this year, 2019. I'll start with a little synopsis. It's a story about a family that's on hard times. The parents are out of work. There's a mom, dad, son, daughter. So for the purpose of this podcast, we, both Yusuf and I, aren't the best at pronouncing these Korean names. So we will mostly refer to this family as mom, dad, son, daughter. They're the Kim family. The dad's name is Ki Taek. The mom's name is Chung Suk. The daughter's name is Ki Jung, goes by Jessica as her English name. And the son's name is Ki Woo, and he goes by Kevin as his English name. So we have this family. The parents are out of work. They're pretty poor. They live like in a garden level, semi-basement, small apartment. You know, they're just on hard times. They have scavenging for Wi-Fi. There's a lot of moments that you see that, okay, they're barely scrapping by. And what do you do when you're in that situation? You look for opportunities to make money any way you can. And they kind of scheme their way into working for a very rich family, the Park family. And for the purpose of this podcast, we'll refer to the Park family, the mom and dad in that family, as Mr. and Mrs. Park. And then they have one son, Da-sung, and one daughter, and her name is Da-hae. And we'll just refer to them as Mr. Park or the Park's kid, Park's son, Park's daughter. Again, because we just don't want to keep butchering their names. So they end up, the mom, dad, son, daughter, Kevin, Jessica, these guys, their family ends up scheming their way into working for the Park's family as basically workers, helpers, housekeeping, driving, tutoring. This just leads to a series of events that leaves you wondering what just happened and what does it mean. So that's just a general synopsis. Great movie generally. I think both Yusuf and I agreed that this is a highly recommended movie from both of us. So we'll get into the scores now and get into the details later on as to why we believe it's such a great movie. Yusuf, you have anything to add to that?
No, I think let's dive into the scores.
All right, cool. I'm going to start with the writing score. I actually like the writing a lot in this movie. I give it an 85. So the way I described this movie to friends after I saw it was, this is a comedy, thriller, and drama. And honestly, the best writing is in the comedy part, and it's actually really funny. I thought it was very funny. And there's actually a lot of, now the themes and motifs in this movie is also very strong. So the way that it's presented through the writing is very well done. It just flows very well. The characters are all believable. Their lines, their acting, everything obviously flows with one another. And the writing stood out to me, so I gave it a score of 85. What about you, Yusuf?
I'm right on the button with you. I have it as an 85 as well. The dialogue pretty much, like, I think you can probably describe most of it in like one of two categories. Some of the dialogue is advancing their scheme, whether they're planning it or whether they're enacting it. And then the other half is, you know, dialogue that kind of exposes the Kim family struggle and kind of their view and what they're looking for here. And those aspects are kind of equally important. So, I mean, I didn't see a lot of fluff really anywhere throughout the movie. Even the scenes where I did feel like, you know, it was just kind of basic chatter, kind of on rethinking it, those scenes are actually pretty introspective into, you know, both the Park family and the Kim's family, and the Kim family's just, you know, outlook on life and kind of like how they view society. So yeah, I had it as an 85. I think one thing I noticed was that there's like, you know, there's obviously a class divide in this movie, and each side's understanding of that divide is a little bit different. So that was really interesting to see how that plays out in their dialogue. So yeah, I mean, I really enjoyed it. I think I might have lost a little bit because of just reading the subtitles. You lose some of the context on the dialogue, but despite that, I thought I you know, it was really an interesting, thoughtful movie. So
yeah, that's one thing to always note with foreign films, especially if you're not a native speaker of the language. You always wonder like what the subtitles may have added or subtracted from what was actually said. I mean, since we can speak, like, we understand Hindi and we watch Indian movies, and we always see instances where the subtitles doesn't necessarily capture what was actually said. It's just getting the point across. I don't know. This is something you have to keep in mind, I guess, when you watch a foreign film with subtitles.
Yeah, there was certain points where they referred to things in a way that is like very American, and that's good because it conveys properly to the American audience. But that's probably not what was the original line. Like, even, you know, just if you had just straight translated the line, you're not getting a clean translation. And even if you were, I mean, nothing translates one to one from a language that's so different, like Korean to English. So, you know, we're definitely missing something there. And well, you know, I think nonetheless, you get, you know, a majority of the context here, but that's, yeah, something to keep in mind. You're always not getting the full picture. So,
all right. So next score, we'll go with acting. I gave this the same as writing. I gave it an 85. Everyone in the movie fit the role very well. The Kim's family, the mom, I kind of like, she just didn't seem the most believable to me. She just seemed I don't know. She wasn't as invested in the family's plan to make some money. And other than her, everyone was great. Mrs. Park was probably my favorite. She just played that naive, quote unquote, as Kevin's friends calls her, a simple. Like, she just played that role incredibly well. Jessica, she was great. Like, she was a true con artist / charlatan, whatever you want to call it. It was believable. The way the characters were set up with the writing and like who they were, like, they all had some depth to them. And the dad, I feel like, had the most depth. So overall, 85 is my score for it. What about you?
I had it as an 80, so I definitely thought it was above average. As we talked about, the balance between the comedy and the drama and the thriller aspects of the movie, that's hard to do. And I thought they really nailed it, especially with the acting. There's a couple characters that really stand out, and you mentioned two of them, right? Mrs. Park is... Yeah, she just plays the oblivious idiot so well. And I mean, her acting was not only effective, but it was also hilarious. I mean, some of the really funny moments in this movie come from the way that she responds to things or the way that she interprets certain things that she sees, you know, just she's always a step behind them with their scheme. So I really enjoyed her acting. And also Jessica, right? I enjoyed her acting a lot because she... You know, based on the way that she's introduced to the Park family, she essentially has license to do and say whatever she wants. And she really takes advantage of that. She plays like that, you know, that kind of withdrawn genius. And she's very blunt and she's very rude to everyone. And everyone just reads that as her being, you know, who she is, kind of this really, you know, genius person that they can't fully understand. And I really like the way that she played that, because you get to see the other side of that, where she's not in that role and she's, you know, she's laughing it off. And so I really enjoyed kind of seeing those two sides of her. Overall, I think some of the other characters, I wasn't able to get like a really clean grasp on them. And again, that has to do with the fact that I can't read their emotions as well because it gets lost in translation. But I didn't think that took away from it. So, you know, I didn't necessarily score them down for that. But, you know, I'm sure that I'm missing some elements here that I might have scored higher because, but I'm just not able to pick up on some of those, you know, those more subtle notions. So still a very high score of an 80.
All right. Next category, we'll go with photography and cinematography. For this category, I thought the cinematography was incredible. I give it a 90. There's almost every single shot, like, seemed super purposeful, and it fed into the narrative that is being presented, which is just, I mean, it's about poverty, and we'll talk a little bit more about it and the themes and motifs. Very few shots I thought were like wasted, and everything seemed to be set up very deliberately. And again, it also helps that the Parks family's house is like this beautiful house in this beautiful location, all this sunlight coming in, this big glass windows. So you could just, like, it feels like you put a camera anywhere and it would look good.
That made for such beautiful shots regardless of what you were seeing, right? I mean,
yeah, but it just still felt so, I mean, it just felt so good. Like, despite, like, even what was happening at times, it was like, man, it looks so good that you're just enjoying what you're seeing. So 90 for me. What about you?
You're going to have to help me out a little bit here, man. I mean, I want to hear more of what you liked so much. But I mean, I had it as an 80, but there was a lot of points that didn't necessarily stand out to me. But I mean, you're right. There was a lot of shots that were just, you know, beautiful by nature, especially when we're in the Park family's environment. Not so much the Kim family's home, obviously. But one thing that was really well done was kind of showing the stark contrast between those two environments. And, you know, there's something to be said also to, like, how the characters react in those two different environments. So I thought that was good. There's a couple other shots that stood out to me as particularly cool. And also, you know, they added a lot of value in terms of just the feel of the movie. There's one in particular where you essentially get Jessica, like, recording a camera shot in slow motion of a guy peeing outside their house. And, like, there was just a lot of comedy, like, conveyed in the way that that shot was taken, and even, like, the soundtrack they had playing behind it at the moment. I thought that was really funny. And then that kind of transitions into Da Song in the Park household, you know, outside in the beautiful sunlight, looking straight at the sun through, like, through some sort of filter. I think he's holding up sunglasses. So I mean, you just get, like, a really good contrast and environment. And both of those shots individually were also just really cool, beautiful shots. So I like the way they use that. They also used rain really well in this movie, kind of like an equalizer. You know, the rain happens everywhere, and the way that they use those shots and the way I felt when I was watching those shots, you know, kind of put me in that moment. So I like that. Definitely, as you mentioned, kind of the class divide is prevalent, and they use the cinematography to make that point and drive it home. So an 80 for me.
Yeah, exactly. So that last point you made, let's just talk about themes and motifs. I gave it a 90. I'll explain a little bit why I gave the cinematography as high as I did. When I meant like deliberate and purposeful, so you have the Kim family that lives in this semi-basement. They're literally at foot level when they look outside their window. They just see people like from the waist down.
Right.
And like the world's just passing them by. Then you have the shots of the Parks family house, which is, they're always showing it from outside, like by the garage, where it's like a road curving upwards. So it's like, you know, on a hill almost. And then even when they go inside, there's like two sets of stairs. Like when he first entered the gate, he goes up the stairs and then there's that big lawn. And then when you're going from the garage, there's that set of stairs with like, you know, when Mr. Park comes home and like the lights are turning on as he comes in. I mean, there's just so much that, and then there's another part of the movie, which I don't want to talk about right now because I don't want to give away spoilers, but we definitely will. And I'll explain to you why I thought it was so like masterful. But yeah, so my themes and motifs is 90 because it's that class divide. So it's about poverty, right? I think that's like the major theme here, like poverty and what it can do and what it can lead to the mental state of a person. Like we hear it all the time. We see it all the time. Like, you know, you have your back against the wall. It's the dog eat dog world. You do what you can do. And some of this stuff is generally kind of lighthearted. It's not really that bad, like what they're doing. I mean, Kevin becomes a tutor for the Park's daughter to teach English. And he's like, hey, they also have a son that is a little artistic. He can get his sister to join in and they'll just make money. It doesn't seem, I mean, I didn't think that was unethical even because these guys are poor. I mean, they're poor as hell. So
yeah, you don't
need
really
some money.
That.
They can do this. I have no issues with it. Like, but then obviously there's some lines that get crossed. I guess it depends on what your definition is of, or where that line is for you. The themes and motifs are strong. And that's like what I was thinking about. And that's like the discussions I was having after the movie. So the 90 score I gave it is because I just think it's really something the director wants us to discuss.
Yeah, I gave it a 95, actually. One thing that I noticed when I was kind of thinking through all the different motifs and themes that they presented, I mean, I can think of maybe like five or six like strong themes that they kind of played out in this movie. And that's a lot for a movie generally to have like five or six main themes like that. And sometimes when you see that, it gets a little bit scatterbrained. But actually, to your point, almost every single one of those themes like is actually a sub theme of just poverty in general and what it does to you. And it's different components of how a person reacts to poverty. Or maybe just showing the difference between, you know, poverty and wealth. So there's actually a lot of depth in this movie in terms of the motifs and themes. And it's not like a overly long movie either. So, I mean, they really work a lot into kind of a compact space. And all the while you're watching a pretty comedic movie, through and through. So like I can imagine that's very difficult to do, to kind of get all these serious points across while keeping the actual shots on the screen, less serious than that. So I thought they did a really good job of that. So I gave it a 95. You know, frankly, I probably could have even gone all the way to 100 because that's not something that you see. Even some of like my favorite movies and directors, I mean, you don't see this many themes all tied together as well as these are. So yeah, I gave it a 95, but really excellent job on the motifs and themes. That's probably the strong suit of this movie.
Speaking of 100, I gave my first 100 and that was for the direction and plot of this movie.
Ooh.
Now, I mean, everything you said about themes and motifs, I agree with you. The only reason I guess I didn't give it a 95 is it's just the way, like it by itself was amazing, but what really tied this movie all together was the direction of this movie and the story itself being just as entertaining as it was. But how the cinematography, the themes and motifs, the writing, and subsequently the acting all worked so like seamlessly was like 100%, in my opinion, like the direction of this movie. The pacing of it was so like well done. The transition from like being a lighthearted comedy to a thriller to a drama, like it was blended so well and it just went from one to another. It made you laugh. It had your heart beating. Like it just, it just had everything, and it was done like super well. It's like one of those things when I look back and think about it, like, what would you have really done differently? And I can't really think of anything because the final product was that good.
Interesting. Okay, so I gave it a 90. I don't disagree with anything you said. Maybe I weighted some of those aspects higher in the, you know, in the motifs and themes, and that's why when I was looking at the story and plot, I didn't necessarily consider those aspects as heavily. But I agree with everything you said. I gave it a 90 because, one, it's really difficult to balance comedy and drama and thriller aspects the way they did. And I mean, I legitimately forgot what kind of movie I was watching on several occasions. And I mean that in the good way. I was just so focused on what was going on that, like, suddenly when the movie snapped back and was a little bit serious, I was taken aback again because, you know, I kept getting a little bit enveloped in whatever I was watching. So, you know, I would be laughing, and then I would lose track of the fact of, you know, how introspective this movie really was being, and the serious aspects would catch me off guard. That happened over and over. So I really like that. In terms of audience connection, I think we can all relate to certain aspects of this movie. Maybe not. I mean, I'm sure we've all been the parasite leeching off somebody at some point, but more specifically, like, there's, you know, just kind of, okay, the movie starts with, you know, who is it? It's the movie starts with Kevin kind of running through their house, struggling to find a Wi-Fi signal, and he can't get it because the one Wi-Fi password he had is no longer valid. They changed the password or whatever, so he can't get on that network anymore. And he's like running around the house looking for it. That's, first of all, so relatable because despite whatever like financial struggles they're going through, not having internet connection is just devastating. I think we can all get that. So, I mean, he's like running around the house looking for it, and his mom's like, I need to check WhatsApp. Like, we need a connection. So I really like kind of how they connected with the audience off the bat. I think one thing I didn't love so much was how the movie rounded out. I think while the ending, I liked it and it was still good. It how do I say this? Without giving too much away, I think things kind of advanced a little bit quicker than I was comfortable with towards the end, where I wanted to see more things play out, but we kind of got a more of an overhead view of kind of how things played out towards the end of the movie. Still good. I enjoyed it. And you're making a strong argument for why it could have been higher than the 90 I gave it.
Yeah. And where does he find the signal for the Wi-Fi? It's right by the toilet in the bathroom.
Yeah. Him and his sister are like huddling into the corner behind the toilet just to check their WhatsApp. Yeah, maybe I've never gone that far, but I mean, we can all relate to you know, being stuck without an internet signal and how disconnected you feel, right? So
I should mention the director's name is Bong Joon-ho. I have seen a couple of his movies other than Parasite. I mean, Memories of a Murder is probably his most famous one. And then I've seen Mother from 2009, both of which I enjoyed, but not as much as I enjoyed Parasite. Anyway, so like according to your order, Yusuf, you like this movie a lot. It comes out to an 87, and for me, it comes out to an 89.
Okay, so we're pretty close overall in the end. And like I said, I think I may have like seen certain aspects of this movie and weighted it in a particular category, and not considered it so much for another category. And that's okay, because in the end, we both liked those aspects of the movie, and it shows in our overall score. So
yeah, definitely. Anyway, this is the moment we'll go for the spoiler alert. Anything we discuss now will include all spoilers in the movie in its entirety. So if you haven't seen it, I probably would go watch this movie before listening to what comes after the spoiler alert, because you don't want to give it away. All right, Yusuf, I have some notes that I did take on my notepad. I feel like we can start with the themes and motifs because everything ties into that anyway.
Yeah, and let's do that.
We can build, like, just branch out from there. All right, so I guess I have, like, my first question. What did you think about the music in the movie?
It was interesting. It threw me off a little bit at certain points, in a way that I liked, because there was certain moments. One that sticks out to me right away is when Kevin goes for his interview to become the tutor at the Park family household. As he's walking through the neighborhood, he's obviously in a super rich subdivision that he's not comfortable in, but the music that they use over that scene is like this, like, I don't know, this like creepy foreshadowing music. And then he kind of, you know, he rings the doorbell and like the door slides open and he just stares at it. And like, you get this like really odd creepy feeling in that moment, which is, you know, it tells you a lot more about what's going to happen way further down the road in this movie than what is kind of immediate to that moment. But I kind of liked how they used that in different ways to either redirect your attention or redirect your mindset as you're watching the movie. There's also, I mean, they also use it comedically. I don't know if you noticed, but there's a couple points where they use like American songs or, you know, just like classic American music, like, you know, like old, I don't know, I think I heard like America the Beautiful at some point or something, but it's not the actual version. It's just like a cover version or somebody humming it. And like, it just added kind of a comedic element to certain scenes where, you know, something more serious is going on and you have this like odd kind of relaxing backdrop to it. So I enjoyed it. Is there something else in particular that stuck out to you about it?
Well, my first time when I watched it, I can't say I noticed it much. Obviously it was there, but my second time I realized how much the music played in how you should be feeling. And like you said, the music was pretty much foreshadowing what was coming next. So it could go from being lighthearted, jolly, and then it could go to being like forbearing and like, okay, what's about to happen, to straight up like scary at times. I just didn't realize how significant it was in my first watch. So I just wanted to see if you felt like its significance in terms of it had a pretty strong role in how we were feeling. Like I'm saying, like when our heart's beating fast during the thriller part, when we're relaxed or when we're laughing, like the music was there. I can't say I noticed. I mean, they had a lot of classical music playing, and there's a couple of scenes where the music was, it was just like so perfect, man. So you mentioned earlier how Mrs. Park, how she and her reactions to things and her, I guess, simplicity like shows. The scene where the family at this point, they are scheming to get the old housekeeper out so that she can be replaced with Mrs. Kim. And, you know, Mr. Kim has this entire plan of going to the hospital, getting a picture of the old housekeeper at the doctor's appointment, which, of course, she's only there because Jessica put, or not, I think Kevin initially puts a peach fuzz on her, which caused her to get an allergic reaction, which causes her to go to the doctors. So Mr. Kim, like, tells Mrs. Park all of this, that, oh, I saw her at the hospital, I heard that she has TB. And when they're coming home from the grocery store after shopping, like the music is playing, you can see Jessica at this point has, quote unquote, poisoned pretty much the old housekeeper with more peach fuzz. So she's like coughing and then she's like leaving the room. There's like the orchestra is blaring in the back and Mr. Kim goes down, squirts some like hot sauce on some tissue and like pulls it out for Mrs. Park to look at, and then she just screams.
Oh my God.
The music in that was like so good. It was super comedic and like almost like suspenseful, but it just works so like perfectly for me.
There's two things that I'll note about that particular scene. I mean, first of all, like you said, it is like hilarious when you know it's coming. You know that like everything is, well, I should say it's orchestrated properly, right? And so that music, that backdrop to it is perfect, because you know that like this whole thing is kind of like a work of art that they're enacting, right? And you're watching it play out, and as Mr. Kim goes to the garbage can, which he pulls out, you know, the napkin that the housekeeper threw away, and he's just sprayed his like hot sauce on it or whatever, so it looks like blood, and he pulls it up and he holds it so Mrs. Park can see it, and he has this look of like total like he has this look of like defeat on his face, like somebody just died. It's like the end of like a tragedy, like watching like a play and like somebody just died. He's on his knees, he's holding up the napkin like it's all over, right? And I mean, first of all, he's doing, you know, he's doing great acting in front of Mrs. Park. But like that scene was just so funny to me, to see like how he is, how he's trying to.
Well, I was gonna say like this scene also, like this sequence of scenes also shows how planned it all was, because it cuts back to Mr. Kim practicing with his son Kevin at their apartment. Like he's rehearsing the lines and he's getting pointers from Kevin, like No, no, say it like this. Say it from like your chest. Say like, you know, condense it into this. Like, I don't know. It was, and then it cuts back to him like continuing that conversation in the car with Mrs. Park. So it just shows us like how orchestrated, like you said, all of this really is.
Yeah, because you get that cut between him actually performing in front of Mrs. Park and then like him holding up the script, practicing it in front of his family, and his son just like, yo, like, take the tone down, dude. You're getting too emotional. You're getting out of control. And then you cut back to him and he's like, okay, look, like, you know, as you know, your housekeeper has a pretty loud voice. I wasn't trying to, you know. And so he's just, they've practiced this multiple times. There's even a shot in there of like Kevin, who is obviously not going to be playing this role, but he's the one who wrote the script. So he's like acting it out for his family to kind of, he's playing it out in his head, showing them like what it's going to be like in real time. And so, I mean, the amount of layers, it really is like, you know, they've prepared a play ahead of time and now they're acting it out. I mean, that scene, yeah, like you said, it was hilarious. And the music not only like made it kind of dramatic in a way, but it also just made it that much funnier to see it actually playing out.
Obviously, the other scene that you mentioned earlier while you were giving your scores, the scene of Jessica recording this drunkard outside that pees in front of their place, and Kevin and Mr. Kim going out to, like, you know, shoo him away with water. Like, the music that's playing at that point, too, and the slow motion going, like, it's so prevalent, is the music is.
And I mean, I think the music just comes in and, like, reminds you of where you are in a lot of situations. The guy peeing in general, he kind of just serves as, you know, like, there's a lot of, even in their environment, they have their own kind of intrusive pests, right? They have the stink bugs, which they complain about a lot. And then there's this guy who just comes and pees in front of their house. And like you said, because they are in like a semi-basement, he's peeing like at basically like shoulder level for them, right? So like they get so annoyed when they see him. And there's a moment where Mr. Kim is like, you know, he's so happy. We all have finally gotten to a better place. You know, he's like giving all this praise. He's talking about how we need to make a quick prayer for Mr. Park, who is providing all this money to our family, knowingly or unknowingly. And then he suddenly gets cut off because he's like, God damn it, that guy is peeing in front of our house again. It's just like, even in those happy moments, those, you know, the intrusive nature of where they live and like their situation, it kind of, you know, they can't escape it. It comes flowing back into their life. So I liked how they used little elements like that. Like, I mean, that guy peeing was hilarious, but it also kind of just reminds you that they can't really get away from the situation they're in. So, and that's, you know, one of several kind of little devices they use in that same manner. I think generally there's kind of this theme, right? That I guess I should say, like, I think that one thing that comes up a lot also is like the smell on them. And it's kind of a subtle indication to like what part of society they come from. So like, they just can't escape that even when they're pretending, there's this mark on them that is gonna point out to anyone who knows how to pay attention that they're not where they belong.
Yeah, so let's talk about, I guess, that major theme or the overarching theme, which is poverty. Because, so I wrote down, obviously there's a lot of this movie has just reminders of, you know, class. Like, you are in what class, and like you're more or less stuck in that class no matter what. And like, the smell is one of those things. Mr. Kim and his family are now presumably making decent money. I mean, they're all more or less leeching off of this really rich family, but that smell is still with them. And then they're reminded of it. And eventually it's the thing that triggers him to like this crazy ending where he just kills Mr. Park, right?
Yeah. Can we talk about that a little bit before we get into like,
well, let's talk about what happens like right before that, more or less, sure. Right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of, so the entire family makes it into the house, right? You got the Mrs. Kim, she's a housekeeper. Mr. Kim is the driver. Kevin, he's the English tutor for the daughter of the Parks. Jessica is the art tutor for the son of the Parks. And then you have the Parks, who are out on a camping trip for Dasong, the Mr. Parks, or the Parks' son, their kid, for his birthday. The Kims are just enjoying themselves, drinking like the alcohol that's in the house. They had like a big meal. And there's some conversations that they talk about that, I mean, this is where I guess the director is choosing to just bring out for in plain view for the audience, like what we're talking about here, which is the poverty. some lines that like stuck out, and then how they played for the rest of the movie. They talk about how Mrs. Park is so nice and she's so simple and naive. But then Mrs. Kim is like, well, if I was rich too, I'd be nice. It's not that she's rich and nice. It's that she's nice because she's rich, and how money is like an iron. And it's just like, you know, irons out all the creases in life and just smooths everything out. So like they're living it, or they're basically talking like in reverence of money, and they don't really regard the Parks family themselves as like, it's not the people themselves that they look up
to. There's no inherent qualities there, right?
They're only just like impressed with the money and the money itself,
right,
and they're saying that it's the money is what makes them special. It's not that they're special that they got rich.
Yeah, I mean, even though like these families get along throughout the entire movie, there's always kind of this tension there, right? And to your point, like the Mrs. Kim is like basically offended that everyone is praising Mrs. Park so much, because she's like, look, like, you know, if I was rich, I would be a different person too. But like, you know, kind of, she's been hardened by kind of the experiences she went through. And, you know, something I noted really early on in the movie was that, like, you know, Mrs. Kim had been successful before they ended up in that situation, right? They kind of show like her medals and everything on the wall of their home. It looked like she was like some sort of track athlete. Like they showed a picture of her like doing like a hammer throw or something like that. But like, you know, she resents where she's ended up. That comes through a lot. I mean, even that entire scene, like I was mentioning about the rain, for once they're sitting inside safe from the rain and they're just looking out into the backyard watching it rain. And like, that was like a thing for them, right? Like they were like, it was like a unique experience. They're like, you know, we're in here and the rain is out there and it's not coming in. The idea of how convenient things have become is not lost on them at all. And you know, you're right. This is the one scene where kind of they talk about it very, very openly.
Yeah. And you mentioned how, like, the families are getting along, but there is this tension, and Mr. Park brings it up quite a bit, actually. He keeps talking about, like, this line, and he's okay with the workers as long as they don't, like, cross this line.
He brings that
basically
up a lot.
He wants, he wants, like, there to be a clear distinction between them as the employer and then their workers as the employees, and he doesn't want that line to be blurred in any way. I mean, Mr. Park, he seems generally nice. He doesn't seem like a bad person in any real way, but he has like moments where he's kind of like dismissive. He's the one who brings up Mr. Kim's smell, and the way he describes it is just, I mean, he called it like, it's like boiling an old rag, that smell. I mean, that's pretty insulting.
There's also a scene where Dasong picks up on the smell first, right? Like I think in that scene everyone smells it for the first time. They smell it on Mr. Kim, but then Dasong is the one who runs over to Mrs. Kim, who is now the housekeeper, and he starts sniffing her, and Mrs. Park's like, what are you doing? And he was like, it's the same smell. They smell the same. They have the same smell. And she's like, shut up and go up to your room, and you know, you have to get back to your lesson with Jessica. And he's just like, she smells like that too. Like, so like, he's the first one, you know,
there's up. Actually a lot of points in the movie where you're thinking the kids are going to like figure it out that what's happening here. There's that moment where Dasong smells and then points it out. Like, hey, they all have like a similar smell to them. And it's also when, okay, let's go back to the night. Let's go back to the night that they're all having fun. I mean, there's just so much to talk about, honestly.
Yeah.
The old housekeeper decides to come back because she tells Mrs. Kim, like, hey, they just kicked me out so quickly. I couldn't get this thing I had in the basement. Can you let me in so I can go get it? She comes in. She's running down into the basement. And this is where, like, the movie is, like, taking this crazy turn. And you kind of just know it. The music changes. The tone changes. The acting changes.
When the doorbell rang, that was the tone of the movie, like, shifted so quickly to like a thriller or even like a horror movie. Like, I was, you know, suddenly I was like on edge about like what was about to happen.
The old housekeeper, and she did a great job. She's like disheveled. She's almost like hysterical. She's like laughing and trying to be super nice, I don't know. It was scary. At that point, it almost felt like a horror movie. And then when they're running down, when they're going to the basement, like the shot that they have is a little like overhead, and it's just, it's going slow in between the halls, but on the turns, it's like speeding up super quickly. Like, I don't know. It's like disorienting almost. And it seems like you're just in there forever until you see, oh man, the old housekeeper's husband has been hiding down in this bunker. Like, what would you call a bunker? A bunker is like beyond a basement, right?
Yeah.
So you have like a semi-basement. Now this is like truly underground.
Right. And this is like hidden away. You know, it's not supposed to be seen. So there's, you know, it was normally covered by like some sort of, you know, there was some sort of furniture in front of it, so you couldn't get to the entrance. It's, you know, way underground. I mean, that's like, you know, you go down two or three flights of steps and you end up in like this hidden bunker. It's small, it's tight, everything's made of concrete, and this guy's living down there, and it, like, so you don't know exactly who he is at first, but essentially the one thing you know right away is that he's starving, right? And he's starving because he was stuck in there, and the housekeeper, since she was fired, was not able to get him any food, because that's where he lives now. And that's when you find out he's down there because, you know, he got into some trouble with some loan sharks or something like that. And so that's where he lives now. Nobody knows where he is. He was snuck into the house at some point. Even the Parks don't know about this bunker. And so that's his life now. He lives down there, and he has almost no interaction with the outside world other than when his wife brings him food.
Yeah. And now this gets into the themes and motifs again. Now you have someone, okay, Joe, you had the Kim family that's poor, living in poverty. And now you have this dude who's like beyond poor. Yeah. And then you see where his mental state is at.
It's not just money at this point, right? It's also like it's fear of your own life. You know, like the Kims, despite their financial troubles, they were safe, right? So, but he's in a whole different world now.
Yeah, and he's clearly lost it. He's like, I've been down here so long, like I feel like everything took place down here, even my wedding. And he has like his pictures. It's a crazy situation.
Right. And I think one thing you notice here is that, like, he has a very different, if you look at him and Mr. Kim, who are kind of in similar, who, I mean, I guess they're not really in similar positions, but, you know, essentially, they have a relationship with Mr. Park, and that shows that a couple times, because even Mr. Kim says, you know, we should make a prayer for Mr. Park because he provides all this money to our family. This guy, he's on a whole different plane. I mean, he basically looks at, because he has no interaction with the outside world, he looks at Mr. Park like a god. So he prays for him every single day. And when he comes home, he like uses his head to smash the controls for each of the lights leading up the staircase. So everyone thinks that those are like motion sensitive lights, but it's actually just this guy in the basement smashing up against each of the controls as Mr. Park walks past them. And he's just listening for Mr. Park's footsteps. So like, yeah, he's completely lost it. But, you know, he has the relationship. He understands how important money is more than anyone else in this movie, right? He's the one that's like figured it out. Like, this is all we have to live on, and this is the only thing that matters. And because he's so removed from the actual people, he doesn't see any sort of parallelism between them and him. He knows he's entirely subservient. So yeah, it's a little bit jarring, but it seems like in his madness, he's figured it out.
Yeah. So at this point, the old housekeeper finds out that, okay, this new housekeeper, Jessica, Kevin, the driver, they're a family. Now you have these two sets of families. You have the old housekeeper and her husband and the Kims. They're both, I guess, from the same part of society. The old housekeeper even mentions it, like, hey, we're, I forget what the term she uses, like, you know, we're workers, like, she keeps calling her sis, right?
Yeah, I mean, they're all working class. It's clear that they were both pulling schemes on the Park family in one way or the other, right? So
the Kims, at least the mom, Mrs. Kim, she's super, like, she doesn't want to, like, be associated with that. She's like, no, we're not the same. We're not like you at all. But then when the old housekeeper finds out about the family, now she has all this leverage. Basically, a fight ensues. The old housekeeper threatens to send a video to Mrs. Park of the entire family, so the Kim's entire scheme would be outed.
Yeah, they're in the middle of the fight when Mrs. Park calls, well, it's raining, so we're just going to cancel our whole camping trip. We're on our way back. So now
8 minutes away.
Yeah, and so now, like, everyone is scrambling. It was hard to even tell what's going on. It's almost like they're all working together for, like, a second. Like, to get everything cleaned up, because none of them want to get caught. But in that, you know, in that quick moment, suddenly the housekeeper and her husband are tied up and they're being shoved back into the bunker. And I think, you know, eventually the family comes home. Everything seems okay. Nobody can tell until the old housekeeper starts running back up the steps. And that is kind of the moment that takes another turn, right? It was pretty funny because you see it from the top of the stairs where Mrs. Kim just kind of gives her kind of like a hip bump, right, and knocks her.
No, it's a kick, man. She lifts her leg up and just like gently kicks back. It's not like a hard kick. It's not like the like Sweet Chin Music or something.
Yeah, it was all finesse. It was like it was very light. That's what I remember. And she goes tumbling back down the stairs. And cracks her head against the wall. So that is another, you know, that's kind of like they kind of shove her back into the bunker, and that's like a problem we're gonna deal with later, I guess. And they go back to pretending like, yeah, we're just, you know, we're the help.
Yeah, so this is like where the, I guess I would say my heart was racing the most. The entire Kim's family is hiding, except for Mrs. Kim, of course, because she's the housekeeper, but Mr. Kim, Jessica, and Kevin are hiding under the coffee table in the living room that looks out into the yard, where the song of the park's son, they're sitting on the couch watching their son out there, who is in his like little teepee. Again, there's so much to talk about because there's a whole Made in USA tent, American Indian. Even for the parks, there's another level of success beyond them, right? It's someone who has studied in the United States. It's someone who speaks English. It's American-made things.
They mention that a lot, right? You keep on hearing about, oh, we got this in the USA, or we got this, you know, made American. Even early on when they're trying to, you know, Kevin is trying to convince Mrs. Park to hire Jessica, he makes particular note to say that she went to Illinois State, and Mrs. Park is like, oh, Illinois, like she gets like that. That was the key word there, right? It's just like it's like this American mentality of just, you know, it's a different level of comfort, right? And I mean, you even see it in that moment, the fact that they are privileged enough that Da Sung is voluntarily going out and sleeping in the rain. And that was like the thing that, you know, the Kim family is just trying to avoid. They're just trying to stay dry, right? But that, you know, yeah. When you get that wealthy, it's all, you know, the paradigm has shifted, right? So
yeah, so the Parks, they fall asleep on the couch, and it's just like the Kims escape, right? They leave the house.
I did want to note right there, right? They're stuck under that table for how long, right? And they have to hear all sorts of stuff. They hear like, oh man, I forgot even that Mr. Park and Mrs. Park are like talking about the pair of underwear that they found in the car.
Yeah,
they didn't know where it came from, and
they're getting intimate, man.
Yeah, some creepy stuff, man. That was some messed up stuff. But you know, in that moment, somehow, you know, well, Mr. Kim is obviously under the table, and Mr. Park with his nose smells that smell that he always smells on Mr. Kim, and he was like, I don't know why I'm smelling it right now. He doesn't put the pieces together that Mr. Kim is right there, but he talks about it in such a derogatory way. And Mr. Kim is just forced to sit there and listen to it in silence. And I think that is kind of the moment where he develops kind of a hatred for Mr. Park in that moment, right?
Yeah. So they get, what's about to happen next is like, I think what just pushes the Kim family. So they eventually escape. And this is the shot that I thought it was like my favorite sequence. They're going home. There's probably like five shots of them just descending stairs, right? There's like them descending the stairs from one road to the other, from the subway down to, or from the street level to the subway, and then another road, and then like the road that they live on, like from their basement, you can just look out and see how it just ascends upward. So they're coming back down, and as they're getting closer and closer to their place, they see that this rain is flooding their entire area, and it's like sewage water. And then they go inside their house, they realize their house is like totally flooded. It's like, you know, near shoulder high in terms of water. The water out of the toilet is just spewing out everywhere. I mean, it's disgusting, right? It's like as low of a moment a family of like people could face in their situation. It's like Jessica just sits on the toilet, takes out a cigarette, and starts smoking.
I wanted to ask you about that. Like, I mean, what was going through her mind there? I was kind of lost. And I mean, she obviously, she's she's almost kind of like beyond it all. But like, yeah, I just didn't know what to take away from that sequence. She just gets so calm suddenly.
I mean, like, what do you, like, I don't know. It probably is like a realization. Like, I mean, it's literally trying to show, like, what a shitty situation, you know? Like, literally.
Yeah.
Like, it's a shitty situation.
There was shit spewing everywhere, so, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, they end up sleeping or spending the remainder of the night at a, like, a gymnasium where obviously it's packed with a lot of other poor people whose houses got flooded that night. That morning, like, for the parks, nothing happened, obviously. They're up, like, on the hills. Their house is totally fine. They're actually, Mrs. Park even mentions, like, the rain was, like, such a blessing that she's talking on the phone to one of the guests that she wants to invite to a impromptu gathering / birthday party for Dasong since the camping trip was cut short because of the rain. So they basically tell the entire Kim family to come over, obviously not knowing that they're a family still. They're telling, I mean, the housekeeper, Mrs. Kim, is going to be there. The driver, Mr. Kim, is going to be driving them around to get, like, the stuff for the party. And Jessica is invited. Their daughter invites Kevin over, too. Kims are totally not about it. Like, they don't want to be there. They just had a horrible night. Their night was totally ruined. And, like, obviously the Parks don't know this. Only the Kims know this, and us, the audience, that there's this whole situation that's in the basement. You know, the old housekeeper whose head got cracked open, and she's in the basement. And then her husband, who's like pretty much lost his mind, is in the basement, and they're tied up down there. I guess I have a question. What do you think this rock that Kevin's friend, Min, he gives the family a rock? And Kevin is just like, keeps saying, like, it's so metaphorical. It's so metaphorical.
So, yeah, I'm wondering if that was something that got lost in translation. I mean, like, the subtitles used the word metaphorical a lot. like
there, yeah. There
were so many moments where, like, Kevin was like, oh, metaphorical. And I'm, like, wondering, maybe that was, like, maybe it was a bit mistranslated or something. But obviously there is a lot of symbolism going on, and it's not lost on any of them.
Well, what is the symbolism of a rock, though? I didn't really get that part.
So, I mean, yeah, that happened so early on that I kind of wasn't, like, ready for it entirely. But essentially, I mean, Min, who's Kevin's friend, who actually introduces them. He's the nexus into the Park family, right? He's the one who first brings Kevin into contact with them, and that's how this whole thing mm-hmm. starts. So his, like, grandfather gives it to them because he knows that they're not in the best of financial situations. So he actually sends it for them. And it's like, it's some sort of scholar's rock, you know, it's like a very beautiful rock that you might find in, like, some sort of, you know, landscape or whatever, like a rock landscape. Or I think Mr. Kim says that, or sorry, Min says, like, it's said that whoever has this rock will find great material wealth, right? And he specifically says material wealth. And as this movie plays out, you see that, like, that's all they're getting. They're getting a lot of physical wealth. They're getting a lot of money. Happiness was never part of the deal. And so, like, things are just going awry, but they got that material wealth. And that's why I think Kevin realizes that. And he's the one who suddenly he's trying to get rid of this rock, like, if it's going to make a difference. And so, you know, he tries to shove it in, like, a pond or something like that. You see a couple instances where he thinks he has to do something with that, and that's going to change their situation. So I think that was something, like, kind of materiality is kind of playing out through that rock, you know, because you see a couple other instances where materiality versus, like, you know, true happiness or, you know, the wealth in the sense of, like, just well-being. You see that play out a couple other times. Mr. Park doesn't seem particularly thrilled with, like, his whole family situation. I don't know. He seems kind of oblivious to it all because Mr. Kim keeps asking him. There's a point, and this is, like, where, like, the lines are almost getting crossed. Mr. Kim, like, actually asks Mr. Park, like, do you love your wife? And Mr. Park, like, is offended for a second. And then he kind of pauses and he's like, yeah, sure. We'll call it love. You know, he just sees things a little bit different. He possesses things versus Mr. Kim, like, thinks, like, oh, like, what a wonderful situation. So he has a family, he has a good job, he has this beautiful home. But, you know, the reality is those are just things. And even the family that Mr. Park has, he doesn't appreciate it more than just a thing that he has. So, you know, I think that we kind of see that line drawn a couple times. It's the materiality versus what Mr. Kim is actually after, which is just, like, bliss. And it's neither of them are finding it.
Yeah, so we're back at this party. This conversation that Kevin is having with Dahae, the girl he's tutoring, I mean, I guess seeing too, because they're pretty much a couple at this point. They're, like, making out, and then they stop making out because she's like, you're thinking about something else. And he's He obviously was, because he, again, had a horrible night the night before.
Right.
And he's just looking out over the party. And he's like, even for like an impromptu gathering, everyone just seems so cool and just there. Like, everyone's just enjoying themselves. And everyone seems like they belong there. And he's like, I mean, he's realizing, like, I don't belong here. Like, it's just not who I am. He is just... he's from another class of people.
Right.
And he decides to take that rock that he brought with him to the party down to the bunker. And as he's going to the bunker, he sees it's the dead body of the old housekeeper. He doesn't know that she's necessarily dead. He's like going up to her asking if she's okay. As he's doing that, the old housekeeper's husband basically he chokes him with like a zip line or something.
I think it's like
a zip tie.
I think it's like the electrical cord that he was tied up with earlier or something like that.
Oh yeah. So he gets him, but as Kevin is about to escape, the old housekeeper's husband, Gensei, he takes the rock and smashes Kevin over the head with it. So Kevin is knocked out cold. Gensei goes upstairs. Now there's another part of the story that we haven't mentioned, which is Jessica talks about how Dasung had an episode in the first grade, and we've come to learn that this episode was when he was in the first grade. Their first his birthday party that year was at home. After the party, he went downstairs to the fridge to eat more of the cake because the cake was that good. As he's eating the cake, he says he saw a ghost coming out of the basement. It wasn't a ghost, it was Gensei, the old housekeeper's husband. And ever since then, he got so freaked out that he actually had a seizure. So ever since then, the Parks family has been doing Dasung's birthday outside of the house, somewhere other than the house. So this is the first time they're doing like a birthday party at the house since that incident. Before this happens, we have a scene with Mr. Park and Mr. Kim. They're dressed up in Native American, American Indian wear. Like, they got the what do you call it? The headwear?
Yeah, they got the headdress on, and they've got...
Yeah, like, the headdress on. So Jessica's supposed to come in with Dasung's cake. And as she's coming in, Mr. Park and Mr. Kim are supposed to jump out as the bad Indians, the bad guys, and attack... obviously playfully Jessica. And then Dasung is going to be the good Indian. He's going to come out and save Jessica and the party, whatever. It's going to continue. As Jessica is coming out with the cake, Gensei, the old housekeeper's husband, Gensei has grabbed a knife from the kitchen. Again, this is after he's knocked Kevin out cold with the rock. So Gensei comes out with a knife and he stabs Jessica, and Jessica is more or less bleeding out to death. And when this happens, again, Dasung gets a seizure. He freaks out again, obviously. He probably recognizes the face, if anything. Point I want to get to is the trigger moment for Mr. Kim when he kills Mr. Park.
Right.
So Mr. Kim obviously sees his daughter get stabbed, and he's going to run out to help her. And as he's doing that, he looks around, and you see his point of view, right? And his point of view is just showing everyone just running away from him, like scattering away. And it reminded me of the conversation that the Kims were having when Mrs. Kim, when they're drunk, of course, this is when they're chilling and at the Park's house. And Mrs. Kim is like, what would happen if Mr. Park came home right now? Mr. Kim would just like run away and hide, you know, scatter like cockroaches do when we turn on the light in our apartment.
Yeah.
Right. So like, that's almost like what it felt like to me when remind you, like, no one at the party knows that Jessica is part of this family. No one in the party knows that Jessica is part of this like class of like poor people. If anything, the Parks think that she is someone of a higher class because she's studied in the United States. She knows English. She's doing art therapy, whatever. But still, like, no one, like, everyone just scatters away from him. No one's there to help. And I mean, not against Mr. Park. He's concerned about his son who's having a seizure. But Mr. Park is asking for the keys, and Mr. Kim throws the keys over to him. But Mrs. Kim kills Gensei.
Yeah, Gensei. And the keys kind of get stuck underneath his body. So
yeah.
Yeah. And I mean, there's kind of this weird tension. You have to remember, right? Nobody knows that the Kim family is the Kim family still. So like, Mr. Park is like, he's furious at Mr. Kim in this moment. He's like, why are you helping her? Like, my son needs, we need to go. My son needs help. And he doesn't understand that, like, Jessica is Mr. Kim's daughter. And so that almost infuriates him even more because of.
And they had like a moment right before the party too, like when Mr. Park is explaining, hey, you have to do this, like play attack against Jessica. So like that son can be a hero. Mr. Kim is clearly not about it. And Mr. Park reminds him like, hey, you're getting paid extra for this. Consider it a part of your work.
Yeah.
It's just another reminder of his place. Like,
you're at this party as an employee, not as a guest, not as part of the.
Yeah, exactly. And I think it's just like a combination of that, right? And also, like before, when they're in the when Mr. Kim is with Mrs. Park, she indicates like the smell by rolling down the window in the back seat and like, you know, putting her finger to her nose because she gets that smell that comes from Mr. Kim. And so it's like one thing after another that Mr. Kim is just triggered to a point where he kills Mr. Park. And that moment comes when Mr. Park has to lift Gunsei's body. And when he does that, like, he gets that stench. And I don't know how I like read this. I read this kind of like Mr. Kim felt almost insulted that to Mr. Park, Mr. Kim and Gunsei are like the same exact person to Mr. Park.
Yeah, you know? I get it. Like that's the constant, right? And so he's disgusted by that smell in the same way that they've always been disgusted with Mr. Kim on some level. But like the comparison to he looks down even more on Gunsei like Mr. Kim does. So like, you know, being compared to something that low, it triggers like a whole different level of rage in him, right?
Yeah, man. And then like that scene and like the slow motion of him just walking down with the overhead shot, I loved it so much. Like, it's almost like peaceful and calm, but man, like what just went down was crazy. Like, even if you felt like some of it coming, you didn't expect it to come like that.
Right. It came very suddenly. And yeah, it was very calm because I think like almost everyone in this sequence, the entire Kim family in this sequence has kind of realized their place suddenly, you know, and it's a little bit jarring, but they've all realized because even Jessica and Kevin, they were invited to the party and Mrs. Park tells them on the phone, like, I'll pay you your usual rate.
Like, you're not like actual guests.
You're not here as a guest.
Like, you're not part of our circle.
Right. So suddenly the whole idea that like we're making money here, that's no longer as much of an incentive to them, right? I mean, they've suddenly realized that like they were never really after the money. The money was nice, but they thought they were being accepted into a higher tier in society, right? And I mean, I don't want to play up on the whole like the parasite aspect of this too, right? Too much, but the idea that they had this like parasitic relationship off that family, you know, they're really realizing what was going on in this moment. The Kim family is because they were allowed entry into this home, into this neighborhood, but they were never really, you know, they weren't genuinely accepted there. And so I think that is kind of what's, you see that trickling through like each of their minds, because Kevin is asking Dahai in their room, like, you know, do I really belong here? And he knows he doesn't. Jessica realized, like, I'm just being paid to be here, so, like, whatever. Then Mr. Park is being told, like, look, you're going to play the bad Indian because I'm paying
Mr.
you.
Kim.
Sorry, yeah, Mr. Kim. He's being told that, you know, you're playing the bad Indian and you're being paid for it, so be happy about it. They all know that, like, well, you know, we're all making our money, but that's, you know, that's not enough for us, or that's not what we were really after, even if we thought we were.
And I mean, at the end of the day, they had like a hard reality check the night before with what happened with the flooding at their place.
Yeah, I don't want to skip past like that. Yeah, like you said, that cinematography in that sequence was amazing, and kind of the rain. I don't know. I just like I felt like cold and wet in that scene, even though I'm sitting in like a warm, dry theater. It like, you know, it really did like shock your system because they seemed so helpless in that moment. And so, yeah, now that they're back in the nice neighborhood, they're all totally unhappy.
I mean, regarding the parasite title, I mean, I also felt that you could in a way apply it towards like the Park family too, because they are helpless without help. Like they can't cook and clean. They can't go out and do like their grocery shopping. They can't raise their kids alone. Like, they just can't do it.
Yeah.
And they're just as much dependent on help as obviously the help would be for money. It's just for different reasons. One, one side of the relationship is to get paid. The other side of the relationship is for help and servitude.
Yeah. And I mean, so it's really, you know, it's not even a parasitic relationship. It's like a symbiotic relationship that's going on between the two families. But I mean, yeah, to your point, there's actually like, there's a lot of subtle cues to the fact that, you know, they're being like the Park family is actually leeching off the Kim family in a lot of ways. I don't know if you noticed, but Dahae really doesn't like studying English at all. And so like the first lesson or maybe the second lesson, she makes a move on Kevin, right? That's how their whole you know, romance starts. But we already know that, you know, Dahae had the same kind of romance going on with Min, who was the previous tutor. So, I mean, yeah. That's just something she does to, you know, get away from studying. And Mrs. Park, who's totally oblivious to that, even mentions like, yeah, we were really happy with him, you know, with Min, regardless of what grades Dahae was getting, we were really happy with him. She doesn't realize why everyone was so happy. Like, she was like, yeah, Dahae really liked him. I don't know. And she doesn't realize what's really going on. Dasong in the same light, right? Dahae mentions this to Kevin, but like Dasong, he may not really be this like abstract genius who's like so deep and introspective with his artwork. Like, he's faking it to a degree because it gets him attention. And by having Jessica as like this art teacher for art therapy or whatever, I mean, he gets to keep playing that up, and you know, it serves him too, because he gets the attention he wants in the way that he wants.
And not just that, I mean, there's a good point that you're making here, is because, I mean, I'm realizing, well, Mrs. Park also relies on the housekeeper, whether it was the old one or Mrs. Kim, to have conversations. She doesn't really talk to her husband. Like, right, when they come home from the camping trip, she's having an open, candid conversation with Mrs. Kim about what happened to Dasong at his first grade birthday party.
I mean, they actually have a real relationship in a sense, but you know, not something that she has with Mr. Park. Mr. Park is, you know, he's all business, and you know, like he says, you know, you can call him in love if you want, but really he's just like, yeah, I mean, she's my wife, so that's like a thing that I have. And I could go on. There's so many subtle cues, like Mr. Kim lets Mr. Park take credit for finding the housekeeper, and he's like, oh nice, like, you know, I'll get some credit with my wife for that, right? I mean, they are really like leeching off the Kim family as much as the Kim family is leeching off of them,
in a way, man, in a way, for sure.
I think one thing we didn't really discuss was the way that the Kim family looks at, like, you know, they have this insane complex scheme that they're hatching, but I think it's Mr. Kim who reminds Kevin. He was like, he says something like, don't make plans. If you can avoid making plans, don't make them, because
this is like at the gym after the flooding and everything,
right? Like, he's like, if I can give you advice, plans never work out. Like, they will absolutely never work out. And
so, he says the only plan that works is no plan at all.
Yeah, there you go. And that's kind of his outlook on life. So despite the fact that they've hatched this insane scheme, in the back of his head somewhere, that's how he feels. So, you know, every time you see somebody make a plan in this movie, I mean, it really does not work out. Kevin, in the beginning of the movie, tells his dad, like, you know, I know I'm forging this document and I'm pretending that I went to this university, but I'm going to really go there. I'm going to go there next year. I'm going to get my diploma. And Mr. Kim kind of says, oh, so you've got a plan. And I thought it was kind of odd at the time, because you don't know the context until later when he has this conversation with Kevin at the gym. But he doesn't like the idea of a plan, because, you know, he just knows that something's going to go awry. And that's kind of, I mean, you know, you can apply that to life generally, right? Like, things never go exactly the way they're supposed to. But, you know, the kind of the desperate situation that this family's in, he, you know, plans not going the way they're supposed to is a really perilous thing. And that finally plays out at the end of the movie, when we find out where Mr. Kim escaped to after killing Mr. Park, right? We find out that he actually escaped into the basement bunker, and that's where he's been living. He's been hiding there, and he's been just surviving, and he has no way out at this point. First of all, he's a criminal, so even if he made it out, and if he got seen, then he would be arrested on the spot as a murderer. And secondly, like, I mean, he doesn't really have anywhere to go. He doesn't know where his family is. I think his family is in jail for some period of time as well, or they go to court at least, and they got
probation.
Right. Kevin needs some sort of medical attention first, so I'm not sure like what his mental state is. I think he doesn't remember all the events for a while. You know, everyone's all over the place. And also, Jessica's dead. So, I mean, they don't really have like a home anyway to go back to. But Kevin does say in that moment, right, he writes his father a letter saying, like, look, I have a plan. I'm going to make
a fundamental plan.
I'm going to make some money. I'm going to do that first. I'm going to go to university still. I'm still going to do it. He hasn't let that go. But he's like, I'm going to make some money first, and I'm going to buy that house. And we're seeing these events unfold as he's describing this plan, right? We're seeing it happen. Mm-hmm. He actually does make the money. He becomes a successful businessman. He buys the house, and he tells his dad, on that day, we're going to be in the backyard, and all you need to do is walk out of the basement, and we'll be reunited. And his father walks out in that moment, out of the basement, into the backyard, you know, and he sees his son and his wife there. And then it all fades away, because we're actually just watching what Kevin is playing.
He's daydreaming.
He's playing it out in his head, what he thinks is going to happen, you know. So, you know, there's our cue to actually how things are going to happen, because he has this plan. So we should know right then that is the one thing that is never going to happen. So, you know, it's a really sad ending. You know, Mr. Kim's been separated from his family, and they're never going to make it, really, is what we're being
told. Yeah. I mean, I feel like a lot of Korean movies have like that melodrama aspect in it. Like, it was missing it throughout the movie, but then it came in at the end.
Yeah. And I mean, again, there's so many different genres that are kind of incorporated here. And so, yeah, by the end of the movie, it's really dramatic, which you weren't getting, you know, full on throughout the movie. But
and those letters, I mean, that was some good writing, man. I loved it.
Oh yeah,
like, they were written so well. I mean, that's through subtitles, I'm sure. Even in the original Korean, it's way better.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, like we said, we're definitely losing something here, but I really did like that part of the ending. Like I said, I think things moved really fast after Mr. Park's murder. Things kind of, you know, time passed really quickly, and we're kind of watching everything in a bit of a time lapse. So I felt like I lost a little bit of depth there. So that's kind of where I was a little bit critical of the end. But I really did love that letter sequence. As we're seeing, you know, Kevin really hasn't lost sight. He still thinks he can make it. And he's still trying to make it, despite what he knows probably will never happen.
I don't know if he knows it or not. But right. Yeah. Anyway, I think we can leave it there, right?
I think so. Overall, I think it has a little bit of something for everyone. So, I mean, I don't think, as you mentioned earlier, I don't think there's anyone I wouldn't recommend this movie to for one reason or the other.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely, I can see it being uncomfortable for some people. But it's just so different from what you get to see on a week to week, or like whenever you watch a movie basis. Like, it's just not, it's something different. So it's worth watching, even if it makes you feel uncomfortable at times. It won't make you feel uncomfortable the entire movie, but at moments it will.
For sure not. I mean, there's so much comedy in this movie. I wish we could just go through like the funniest moments. It kind of is spread throughout the movie. So like, even if you feel uncomfortable, I mean, there's a lot of lighthearted humor going on here.
There is, yeah. And I mean, like the dynamic of the family, both families, it's just so funny to me. Like, like at the end when when Kevin wakes up from his head injury, and he's talking about how you have a doctor that doesn't look like a doctor, and then a cop that doesn't look like a cop. And it's just like a short, funny sequence there. There's a sequence, or there's a scene where when Mrs. Park eats the ramen at home, and Dahae is just like, what the hell, mom? Why didn't you ask me? I like ramen. Like, you asked, you made it, or it got made for Dasong. You asked dad about it. And then you ate it yourself. You didn't even ask me. And she's just like, well, do you want the housekeeper to make you some? And she's like, that's not the point.
Yeah. I mean, there's like a, I don't know. It's like, it's funny because you're always comparing the two families, and Jessica like doesn't view anything that way. So it's just funny to see. I don't know. You can call it first world problems, but it's just like, there's like all these little like jabs that they're taking at each other, or like the little things that get them upset. It was really fun to watch. I think one thing that I just thought of now is like, you know, Jessica is, she's having a conversation with Mrs. Park about the driver, and like, you know, the original driver, and, you know, the inappropriate things that he did. And Jessica says like, oh, he was so nice. He was, you know, he was trying to be considerate. And Mrs. Park, of all people, is like, oh, no, no, no. You're so naive and innocent. You have much to learn about people, is what she says. And while she's being like conned, like out of her mind, right? So there's a lot of like fun little jabs there. And I you know what I noticed watching this in a theater with you know, a whole audience, I mean, nobody was like really laughing at all these little bits. And one that might have to do again with just watching it in Korean, you couldn't necessarily tell that they were joking, but like Once you pick up on the fact that they are like trying to be, you know, outwardly funny, there's a lot of comedic moments in this movie.
I watched this twice, right? First time I watched it at a screening. At the screening, the audience was way more engaged, I would say. Many more laughs, many more gasps. You know, it felt like everyone was, I mean, I guess that's just the difference between like a screening audience versus a just general public audience. Because when I watched it again, I went with my wife for the second time. No one had as strong reactions to the jokes or to quote unquote the twists or the drama.
Yeah. And I mean, that might have to be, it definitely took a little bit more processing to kind of figure out what was going on at certain points, or really, I mean, to appreciate kind of the tone of certain scenes. So, I mean, that's something that kind of, if you go in with the right mindset, I think you can really pick up on a lot of the comedy. And I mean, I there was points where I was cracking up and nobody was laughing with me. So I was kind of sad, but I mean, it was a really funny movie, so.
All right, man, I think we'll leave it at this point. Thank you for listening to this production of The Twice Over. If you would like to keep up with us, please subscribe wherever you listen and check out our website, thetwiceover.com. And follow us at The Twice Over on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. If you would like to support us, you can do so on Patreon, or you can just tell a friend about this podcast. And finally, if there are any comments or feedback, please email them to us at comments@thetwiceover.com, or you can just tweet at us. The music you hear is from Amerigo Gazaway. Check him out on Bandcamp and Spotify. We'll be back next week with another episode. I don't think I mentioned the director's name in the beginning, which is my bad.
We should probably do that. He deserves some credit for this movie, a little bit.